without wasting any time, let's start with this. So, Leanne, when you started in broad spectrum the RPA journey, what were the, from a leadership standpoint, what are the business objectives you were trying to tackle? And how did it go about it?
Well, I think one of the things that was really clear was we had to be clear what the business objectives were. And I have spoken to a lot of people, and I think sometimes we dress it up. In broad spectrum, it was really clear we were there to reduce costs. So we didn't tell people anything different. That was our mission, was to take cost out of our processes. And the reason we were doing that was so that when we commercialise them, we could actually make a margin. If your cost is down and your price is up here, you need to make a margin. So we were really clear with people what we're about.
And how does it start in a university, in education? Where does it stand? How did the whole journey got started?
I think it's been a very interesting journey for us because I actually had the whole analytics and the reporting portfolio for the university. And I could always see that there are some, you know, the sort of like what we can fill in the gaps from the process improvement point of view. And I could always tell the executives that if it takes too long for me to build a report, it means there's some gaps in the information and that someone hasn't done the job in the right way. So that's where when I saw the RPA first time, I was like, oh, this is what I've been looking for. So I started to build a prototype myself. And I had to pick up a process which was simple enough to implement, but yet, you know, complicated enough so that the executives can have the faith in that. So the process I picked up was we have the agents working for us globally to send the students to us. So that's the process I picked up because it involves the stakeholders across the globe. So I started to put the POC for that, and when executives looked into that, they were actually really, they could see the value for it. And one of the benefits we have got is that one of our senior deputy vice chancellor, he comes from the background of machine learning and the artificial intelligence. That's what he used to teach. So he could actually see the benefit of RPA and how we can start to leverage the value out of it. But one of the key drivers was not only the financial gains, but how do we create capacity for the academia so that they can start to focus more on the teaching, learning, and research rather than just the cost cutting.
Leanne, when I was going through broad spectrum story, one thing that stood out was that you played it like a coach of a sports team. You know, the way the coach goes first five plays, you went first five processes. How did you pick the first five processes? What are the criteria?
Very early on, I spoke to anybody who would speak to me. And this is at the end of 2015, so this is still relatively new. And a lot of those conversations had to go offshore, but I was looking for who could actually help me make sense of what was happening in RPA. And I came across Moet from Minefields and decided that this was a good strategy to link up with a consulting company who was independent of all the vendors and give me some clarity because there are a lot of vendors out there. I researched maybe 30, 40 of them, and believe me, some of them are really exotic, particularly out of Eastern Europe, and you know, they're a little bit scary. Do you want to partner with them? Looking at even how they were financially structured. So where were they getting their money from? Because were they going to be here tomorrow? So we worked with Minefields and we did a very high level business case to start with. And that really looked at 20 processes. We confined or we constrained what we were doing to shared services. So we didn't try and do the whole company. We very deliberately said, let's look internally where we're not necessarily, you know, we've got to learn and we've got to dabble and we've got to take risk. So we don't want to be going out and doing something to a customer the first time. We want to do it to ourselves first. So we constrained it to shared services. We came up with 20. The business case stood up on those 20, but we then down-selected to five key processes. The processes that we chose, I think the two really good ones were in group finance because they were easy. So we did allocations, which were called strategic resource allocations, but you know, everybody hates allocations no matter what you call them. So we chose allocations because you've got to calculate them once a month. Right? It's based on revenue and it's just a lot of spreadsheets and a lot of churn, so that's very contained. External debtors aging, very similar, another group finance process. We then chose employee onboarding, harder because it was partially offshore, outsourced, and partially onshore. So we had the complexity now of dealing with an Indian provider and this is again late 2015, who was somewhat scared of what this all meant. And we were still in an FTE-based contract at that stage, so they could see their revenue coming down. And I tried to go through a program of assuring them, if you do this really well with us, then there's all these other processes you don't do today. So show me what you can do, because we've got more work to do. And I do think that's the right strategy in working with offshore providers. But you've got to empathise with them, because it was a big unknown to them as well. So employee onboarding, vendor reconciliation was very similar. What we came up with in vendor reconciliation was a lot of unstructured data. So that was one of the things we learned. And the technology is definitely catching up. It wasn't necessarily there at that point in time, but it's definitely catching up. And that was one of the learnings. Put in what you can. Don't try and force fit it. Let the technology catch up and just keep going, keep rolling with this program across intelligent process automation. And the last one was one, it's one of my favourites. It does touch the business, but it was a catering application called JMix, and it was with one of our accounts with Defence. So you can imagine, you don't want a whole lot of chefs having to get ingredients into SAP across, you know, 400 bases with flour and fingers, and they really hate doing it. But the business problem we were trying to solve was actually they never liked doing the goods receipting. So what we had was a lot of vendors who didn't get paid on time, and it's really, really hard to get better prices with vendors when you're not paying them to start with. So we managed to automate a lot of the process and take that away from the chefs actually having to do that. So I thought that was a really good example that was starting to touch into the business, into the supply chain.
You have a similar story on the agent payment, right?
Yes.
Because I just took the last process on the vendor payment. So if you can share a little bit about that story. But one thing I liked in Edith Cohen program is because of your background in AI, ETL, analytics, you put bot governance at a very early stage. Tell me a little bit about what was that bot governance?
So the crux for me was basically put the governance first as much as possible, and we were still developing the bots in parallel, so that we were losing time. But one of the key benefits I saw with the RPA was that how we can start to use this in actually improving the quality of our decision making. So the first thing I did was I actually started to put the meta model for the decision making within the organization. So that wherever we are going, improving the processes, I should be actually collecting a lot of metadata about the decision. I think that was the point of the previous discussion, to are we collecting actually any data about the data improvement or about all these initiatives. So that was the first thing I started to design, was the decision-making meta model itself. And I took less of a process view and more of a decision view. So what decisions are we making in the corporate world? What information do we need to make the decisions, and how does this information come together to make a decision? If there's a gap in the information, then it means that we need to go and improve our source systems. So if we are just making the decisions without the information, it means we are making the decisions on the gut feel. It means that there's going to be an issue with the quality of the decision. So that was part one of the governance. Then we started to build that, how are we going to empower the users across the organization to actually start to do their own sort of default development. And for that, we started to design the right templates so that they can actually start to tell me what decisions they are making in the process and all the metadata that hangs around the decision model. The other thing that we did was we started to design the decision maturity framework, which is very easy for the stakeholders to understand, that how does the decision matures within the organization. So we need to have all the information first, then we need to build workflows. Then we can start to do the insight automation, which is all about the analytics. Then we can start to go into the task automation, and then we can start to go into the artificial intelligence or the cognitive capabilities. But we need to first understand the decision that we're trying to improve. So they were all those things that were part of the governance. And then how do we then look at the people side, how the trainings are going to happen, and then how, even once the bots are live, how are we going to audit them? What is the process to audit it? So if the source systems start to change, that was a big issue from the technology point of view. But within my meta model, I started to capture what source systems and even what screens is bot accessing. So if there's a change in the source system, I can just very quickly give the analysis to the IT department to say, these are the screens, this is the data that my bot is accessing. So if a new batch or a new version of the software is going to change these part of the source system, then we need to change the box. Or the automation, anywhere itself starts to change, and what is the process within the organization. So we started to think of all those scenarios up front and started to develop the racing models to say who is going to be responsible and accountable when these things start to happen. So it was a, in parallel to the bots, this was one of the most critical things, especially coming from finance area, the audit was very important for us.
It's fascinating, we don't have much time here to discuss this, but if you get a chance, we'll talk to Harpreet. I don't know whether it's academia or not, but it's an amazing model of decision making. What I've learned is that that has made life much easier in you working with your stakeholders in driving the behavior. If you can just quickly touch up on what role did RPA play? Because did it help?
RPA has been a key enabler for us. This was the way I could actually really demonstrate that how we can start to improve the quality of decision making within the organization. Because all the information is all sitting within the systems, but a lot of the workforce is just going and collating the information. Because the decision is still to be made based on the information that's residing within the system. So once we start to take a very decision-centric view of the world, and then we can articulate that how RPA can actually enable that decision, because all we are spending time is actually getting this information from the five systems. And the agent commission is a very, very good use case of that. For example, the only decision we were making in that whole process, it was a process of 5 or 6 A3 sheets. But the actual decision is that how much money do I owe to my agent? It's only one decision. And the information is coming from 4 or 5 systems. But once we could bring the discussion to this one decision, the whole complexity went away. So all I need to understand was where is the information coming from? And then they could say, this is how it's coming from 4 or 5 systems. Here are the data quality issues. We start to fix the data quality issues. And then through the RPA, I could then demonstrate, see, what is the value of RPA? That it can bring all the information together. It can actually generate the invoice for you. And it can even email the invoice to the agent. So it was a key enabler for me. Without RPA, I would have never been able to do this thing.
Interesting. It's not decisions driven by process, but process driven by decisions. Leanne, I heard somewhere that only thing that you have to fear is fear itself. And any new technology, when it starts, for rightly so, it starts with a lot of questions and doubts. And rightly so. From a leader's standpoint, one of the best thing you can do in the midst of that is communicate openly, transparently, educate. You are very big on this, mm-hmm. and you led that very well from broad spectrum. How did you go about doing that? If you can share with them the specific things.
It's an area of, I think, great importance, and it's a real passion for me. Not only in broad spectrum, but in these events, in talking to anyone, I think there is a huge need to lift the conversation up beyond RPA and talk about the whole landscape of what we're trying to do. And that, of course, feeds into what is the future of work. And I saw there was a question about that. That's, I think, enormously important that we have that dialogue in the workforce, because there is huge change ahead of us that we need to deal with. Good, open, authentic communication from the shop floor to the chairman of the board, and that's I have spoken to the chairman and the ex-chairman broad spectrum before it was taken over by Ferrovial, and he was actually on another board which was a legal firm. And heaven help us if we've got lawyers trying to understand RPA and tell us what we're saying. But anyway, they were. you need to paint that bigger picture. It's not just RPA, it's about the whole automation landscape, whether it's autonomous computing, whether it's natural language, whether it's autonomous cars. There was a great, I love using examples. Stories are extremely powerful, and anybody in HR, I'm probably singing to their hymn book. But using stories about what is actually happening. There was one recently, probably a couple of months ago, using WhatsApp. And I thought this was incredible. They set up a, it's not commercialized, but if you can imagine using very high powered cameras to scan your body for melanoma. So instead of going every 6 months and asking a doctor to play spot the difference, it's actually using Watson. And it stores all that data, and then it compares it globally with what happens with other people, and then gives that to the doctor, who can then do their job of helping you if you have a problem. So using those examples, autonomous vehicles is another one. It's great. There's an MIT tool I really like, which you can go online and do, and it helps you understand. You actually have to code all the decisions that an autonomous vehicle needs to make, including if it's got a choice to kill people in the car or kill people on the street, what does it do? Right? So all of those things have to be encountered, they have to be programmed. So using stories of what's happening with the technology in the world is really important. I think talking about people's fears about what's happening in the workforce is very important. We have to step up to that. That's a leadership discussion. People need to be aligned with where we're going, and the way they will align is when they understand it and they can understand the context to them as a person. And Australia being a very individual culture, we need to understand what does it actually mean. Now, it doesn't mean I have the answer of you'll be doing this in 10 years or 15 years, but you talk about the possibilities. What are the other roles that are emerging? And there's some great data out there about roles that are emerged in the last 5 years, that have emerged in the next 30 years was the longest I found, somebody predicting that. But it empowers people to go and think about that. What do they do with their skills? You know, where should they chart their course? And let them come back to you and throw around ideas and share what they're thinking and share their fears with you, because this is uncharted waters and we all have to go on the journey together. So from a change management point of view, I can't stress enough how much you need to communicate honestly, authentically about what this is about, what you don't know yet, but empower people with as much information as you can.
On a closing front, if you have to share one or two key learnings till now, right, that you want to share with, a lot of people are already on this journey or are getting started.
Yep.
What are those one or two important learnings that you, I know communication has been one of the biggest things that you've been always advocating.
Look, I think at a really practical level, so going from the visionary, you know, business leadership point of view, I think what I would do differently is probably try and have our IT people come on the journey earlier. We did have some resistance there. We did get around it, but it was seen as, well, you know what, we've done automation in IT years ago, it's just more of the same. And it's not more of the same. So we didn't quite get them to come on the journey how we needed to. And I found, because I was new, I got all the newbies as well. That's not really helpful. When you've got new and new people together, you actually need to give you some experienced people to help me, you know, chart around IT. So that's one thing I would have liked to have engaged them better earlier. And I take that as my responsibility to do that. The second thing I think is the overall setup. So when you're outsourced, and we were outsourced on the IT side and some of the processes, it's really a lot more complicated than when it's just internal. So you've got multiple stakeholders you've got to manage. They're in the sort of fear syndrome as well, back in, you know, the end of 2015. So you've got your own internal organisation, these two organisations that are fearful, and then I've got everybody else knocking on the door saying I want the business as well. So you've got all of these stakeholders that you're trying to manage. And I think that takes a lot of time to do that. Again, it comes back to communication. You have to be honest with the vendors. Where are you going? What do you expect of them? How is this going to work? It is a commercial relationship. They're not there to lose money. So you need to figure out how are you going to work in the future? What is the role of those people? And I think, you know, that was very difficult to get through. I think we did get through it in the end, and we set up a framework before I left that would enable it, but it was quite hard.
Apreet, what next in EDIPCO in the next few months? What are you trying to get?
The key thing for us is now to start to scale up. Like, we've got all the governance, all the environments, everything has been set up. So we are now scaling up our journey of, I don't call it as an RPA journey, I always call it as a decision maturity journey within the organization to lead into the research area. We are now starting to work into the how we can improve the quality of decision making within the research administration, and even some of the decision making from the work integrated learning point of view. That's where we are implementing RPA. We are also scaling it up within the Student Services Center, where how we can start to use these capabilities to, you know, from the front end student facing decisions that we take. The other thing from the, because I come from an academic institution, I would really want to see that how we can actually contribute to create the workforce of the future. That's the discussion I've now started to have with the academics within our School of Science or the School of IT, like how we can start to already embed these things into our curriculums and we can create the workforce of the future, or how we can even start to do some research within this space. So that's where I see the future of these capabilities from our organizational point of view.
Automation courses are the core leaders. Fantastic. We are just out of time. We have time for questions from the audience. If there is any question from the audience.
Okay, who's in the mood for a question? Okay, I'll give you one quick one actually. So, Leanne, great observation around lifting up the conversation beyond RPA. Any tips on doing that when the board and the executive team are striving for the short-term FTE savings from RPA? What's the way in to lift that conversation beyond that?
Well, our board should be strategic. You would hope they are interested. You know, there are some great charts out there, very simple charts. I often use the one from HFS, Horses for Sources, which just chart out the technologies and where they actually fit in. I think sometimes people assume, and I am on the board, that board members know more than they actually do. So you've got to use really good communication skills so you're not patronising them, but you are allowing them to understand the various technologies, because while we may take it for granted that we know what autonomous computing is or natural language, don't take it for granted that a board does. They're operating in a different area and not necessarily familiar with the terminology. Using examples is really, really, I think, important. Again, relevant examples. And then, you know, the management side says, I want the cost savings, I want the errors out, I want the efficiency. You know, obviously, improved speed to market is always a great one that gets people's attention. Improved customer service, customer experience is, I mean, everybody knows the future for clients is all about customer experience and trust. So play to those two things and you'll generally get a hearing with the board. So you can definitely improve the customer experience, maybe the trust. I mean, we should be able to trust these robots, I think. So, I mean, you can certainly audit them to death. That's good. But you know, maybe that's another change management thing that people need to go through. But that's how I would approach it.
The great thing about any technology journey is that it's not about technology, it's about people. I'll encourage you guys to talk to them after this, because with every unique story, there's a unique learning, and it's good if you can share and learn from each other. With that, thanks a lot for all your time, and thanks a lot for listening and being a great audience. Thank you.